this time I'd like to call the Rockingham County Board of Commissioners regular meeting to order, February 4th, 2013, here at the Judicial Center in Wentworth. And if you would, if you got a cell phone, put it on vibrate or mute, please. And at this time, if you'd like to stand with me, we're going to have the invocation done by the county manager and the Pledge of Allegiance led by Commissioner Richardson. If you'd do that at this time, I appreciate it.
Would please bow your head and let us pray. Our God in heaven, we thank you for this evening to gather together for this Board of Commissioners meeting. We ask your guidance for our national, state, and county leaders during these times of economic crises. We also ask your presence and comfort for each of our servicemen and women. As we begin this meeting tonight, we thank you for the abilities you have granted us and the opportunities we have to serve our citizens. We ask that you help us in our planning and sharing to make our services to the citizens of Rockingham County more efficient and productive. Thank you for your presence with us tonight and for guiding us through the business at hand. In God's name we pray, amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you everyone for coming out tonight, and as always, I want to thank news media, our Rockingham Update, as well as school board and Forest Ray and the other news media that's here. Commissioners, you've had the agenda in front of you for about a week, and if there's the only other item we have to add, there's a new business item 11 that came up, and we will be going into closed session for economic development issue. And the council will give us that number when we get down to it. But at this time, if there's no discussion or questions about the agenda for this evening, I'll entertain a motion for approval.
So moved. I second.
Okay, a motion made by Commissioner Richardson, seconded by Commissioner Travis. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise. So carried. The consent agenda, as we have changed our format this year, the explanation of the consent agenda is laying out there at the podium. And if you get any confusion on items C and D, which talks about the Yanceyville Fire Department requesting some money and the Draper Fire Department requesting some money, those are tax funds that we collect their fire tax into our coffers, and when they ask for it, we give them their fire tax back. So it's their money, we just hold on to it till they ask for it, and we give it to them as they need. So at this time, I'll entertain a motion for the approval of the consent agenda.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion for approval of consent agenda, February 4th, 2013.
Okay. A motion made by Commissioner Travis, seconded by Commissioner Duncan. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise. So carried. This time we'll get down to item number 6, our public comment period. And as everyone should know, we've developed our nice little 3-minute discussion time, and we did have one person to sign up. Somebody out can't, I don't believe I know, Mr. Bobby Stanley. All right. Would state your name and address, and you know the routine.
Okay, Bobby R. Stanley, 628 Young Road, Stoneport, North Carolina, 27048. And the subject is broadband. You know, broadband's probably about where electric power was in this county in the 1930s. It is a necessity. But I want to talk about something that happened when I was on the board. It was stimulus money by the federal government, late 2009, maybe early 2010. $7.1 billion of stimulus money was available nationwide. $2.1 billion from the USDA and $5 billion from the Department of Commerce. We chose, now we had to do a $49,000 study. It's the only study I ever voted for on that board, but I did vote for that. I thought broadband, and I was told that we'd get through $4 or $5 billion out of this to help these rural areas. Well, we voted for it, they run the study, and it was a necessity to apply for this stimulus money. We didn't get nothing. It was $85 million from the USDA part to come to the state of North Carolina. Wilkes County, I think, got about $18 million, and Roberson County got around $21 or $22 million. And what happened to us, I don't know. I asked questions, I didn't get answers. You don't know everything, you've got no way of knowing everything. But that, if we'd have got the stimulus money, our county would have had some money. This money had no catches to it. You didn't have to pay it back. It was just federal stimulus money. That we could have maybe subsidized these, got these lines out of where they need to be. I know you've got calls, Mr. Mabe, from the Price area. Some people I got them to. They work for Moorhead Hospital, they work at home, and they're having a hard time keeping the job because there's no broadband there. If we don't, you know, in the state of North Carolina, it's about 15 urban counties and 85 rural counties. And if we don't get broadband out here, or stuff to where we can compete on this global market, we're getting left out. So when you fellas go through this process, please think this out extremely well. We really need these things to happen. And on, I'll still be there some second. On this studies or consultants, and I had that wrote down there. I am not a consultant man. I'd old courthouse had about three of them before they finally made a move. The landfills had a couple I know of. And every time you don't know, all they tell you is the same thing he told you before. It's just not. We had a space needs study here, $81,500. He may as well have made a fire with that money. And he got the same thing out of it. Thank you. Bye, Clerk.
Okay, thank you, Bobby, for your comment. And we did have one more, Sheriff Sam Page. Just got back from Washington. I hope he talked some sense into some folks up there. Good luck to you.
Mr. Chair, it was a great experience, but first of all, I do want to thank the commissioners and the chair for allowing me the opportunity to go up and participate with the National Sheriff's Association. Also, I did do some senatorial visits, and I'll kind of just give you a real brief here. I am with the National Sheriff's Association. It was the winter conference. The purpose was for Border Security and Immigrations Committee, what I attended. I am the co-vice chair, just got appointed this year with a sheriff from Texas on there. And also training and technology briefings. We met several vendors, and also I had meetings with fellow sheriffs regarding issues that are facing other sheriffs across America. That's very common that we have with each other. I did attend meetings with Senator Burr and staff, and also Senator Hagan and staff. Had discussion on immigration policy with one of the points, discussion on gun control legislation, mental health support by providing funding to the back to the states to help us in those areas, and also school safety by providing federal funding for school resource officers, psychologists in our schools, and also safety training and anti-bullying training. So we asked for some funds. Also, I had a meeting with Senator Marco Rubio's staff out of Florida. I want to have some discussion also on immigration reform and kind of where we were at on that. And so it's in early stages. I also attended the, you probably saw this on TV, the Senate Judiciary hearing on gun violence in America. It was very educational, but the primary focal point was assault rifle ban and high-capacity magazines, and I have a statement I'd like to read. To our commissioners of the Rockingham County Sheriff's Office, Sheriff Sam Page, as the elected sheriff of Rockingham County, North Carolina, I recognize the primary responsibility of law enforcement is to protect the citizens and preserve the individual rights and freedoms. I have been honored to have been elected four terms by the citizens of my county, and I have sworn an oath each time to support, obey, and defend the Constitution of the United States and the North Carolina Constitution. I have worked in law enforcement in this great county for more than 31 years and upheld that oath. in accordance with the Second Amendment of the Constitution of the United States of America, I believe that all law-abiding citizens have the right to own, possess, and keep and bear arms. I will not support any efforts in Congress, let me be clear, I will not support any efforts in Congress to infringe upon the constitutional liberties of responsible citizens in Rockingham County. I will continue to stand with my citizens to ensure that their rights under the Constitution and the Bill of Rights will not be infringed.
Okay, thank you a whole lot, Sam. I hope you are, hope everything that was very beneficial that gets some response from our legislators from the Senate and in the House up there that supports that Second Amendment. So I appreciate it, appreciate what you're doing with the immigration law as well. It's something certainly the Congress is going to have to address.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, at this time, the commissioners have their 3 minutes worth. So at this time, I'll start with Commissioner Duncan, the new grandpa.
Thanks, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just got three things I want to mention, and one of them is I would like to request some information, and it was about the broadband and cell service we discussed a couple weeks ago that is regulated by the state. And I wish it would be possible for all members to get a copy of that ordinance, if it's possible, from the state, whatever the law says on regulations of broadband, cell towers, since we have no control here over our own Time Warner, Central, whatever. I want to thank the staff for when we make a request. I've noticed that they're very prompt, very professional, and right on getting the information back to us. So I just want to thank the staff, especially for the little speed limit thing over here where people walk to make it safer for them. And another thing, I guess this is just something I've got an issue with, but nothing to do with this board or anybody here, but I noticed today, I heard on the news to where there's more government agencies going to ban smoking and using tobacco products on any government property, even outside. That's something I've always had an issue with, because when tobacco built, a lot of government buildings we operate out of, and how important tobacco is to Rockingham County. And it bothers me that when all these grants come available, the government's the first one in line to get their hands on these grants. So I hope that when that time comes around, these people will think about where the money's coming from. That's just something that always it's just an issue with me, and I guess I just got off the soapbox.
All right, thank you, and congratulations on
thanks, sir.
Your grandchild. Commissioner Travis?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I too want to congratulate Commissioner Duncan. I call him Papa Duncan, but Bobby, I understand your request, and I think everybody on this board understands the need for broadband in the area, but I think me and you disagree on how to fulfill that need. I don't think it's government responsibility to give money to private organizations to go where they need it. I think it's government's responsibility to get the data together and present it to these private organizations and entice them to go there. I don't think government should be involved in doing broadband or stuff like that. But I do think it's part of our duty to promote it to these private groups, and especially get information to them to say, hey, you got 100 people in this area that have no broadband, and we know of at least 80 that want to sign up. I think that's a good selling point. I think that's part of the government's job. I will never vote to give taxpayers money to some kind of group to expand broadband or cell towers. I don't think that is government's job. I don't want to get in that business, even though I know how important broadband is for economic development. But I think our county manager and his team are working real hard on presenting that information to private businesses like AT&T and Verizon. I think we've got meetings coming up with that, right? Mm-hmm. So, I think the county's doing their part, but I also know what you didn't hear at the last meeting was there's a company out there that wants to do it for free. So why would I give money to it if they're willing to do it for free? And which they should anyway. As far as Sheriff, I appreciate everything you do. I think he's probably left, didn't he, Tinker? But and I agree with Mr. Duncan. I've always had a problem with the tobacco issue. I think I was the only one up here last time to kind of fault him a little bit. I think Forrest knows that. But other issue, my main issue right now is economic development. And we had a meeting at a retreat, and I think it's going to come out that everybody on this board, their biggest issue is economic development. And I, too, want to thank the staff for the retreat and everything that's going on. I think y'all are doing a superb job, and I think our county's the best that there is. So we're working hard for you, and thank you.
Okay, thank you, Commissioner Travis. Commissioner Ritz?
I feel complimented that Bobby Stanley thinks that has got confidence anyhow that we can find out some piece of information he is unable to do when he was a commissioner up here. I particularly appreciate Bobby and people like him that take the time to stay engaged. It's very important. And I want to be a little bit redundant about a brief statement that I made at our last retreat meeting, but I think deserves repeating, and that is, your school board, your commissioners, and your police force, that includes the county sheriff and the municipalities, are working diligently to improve the safety for our students. You'll only see it if we mess up. And due to the nature of this sort of work, you won't necessarily see everything that's being done. But keep encouraging them, and we'll do it.
Okay, thank you, Commissioner Richardson. Commissioner Caldwell?
Thank you. I want to also thank our staff, especially Lance. I call Lance quite a bit, and he gets back to me real quick and gives me the information that I'm looking for. We've got a good staff, I think, and I want to thank Sam for his trip to Washington and everything he's trying to get accomplished up there. That's three things that's real hot topics right now across the country. And I appreciate you going up and taking care of that. Bobby, we know the need for the broadband, and we are working diligently to try to get that service expanded. I got to agree with Craig, and I don't like giving money to a company that's going to sit there and make money off of this just to set it up. We just got to create an environment for them to go in there and make the money on their own. And we will work hard to try to find an adequate resolution to that to get the rest of the county covered. I think we need some more competition out there. That might be a good thing. So that's all I got.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Caldwell. Broadband is a something that's very high on our list. We've been I've been on this board here going on 3 years now, and it'll come up out of the 24 meetings we have. It'll come up 18 of them, and we're still trying to complete that. I know Mark Wells is working with it. And we're trying to find funds and monies to make this happen. Now, whatever happened to the state money, when you get down to Raleigh, if you don't have some good pull, because I've been down there a few times on some meetings, and the way you get money down in Raleigh is you got to have some pretty good pull with your legislators, and they got to have some solid pull. and of course, they start getting teamed up with some of their other friends, and sort of the big dog barks loudest, and one's going to get the money. And sometimes, if you ain't got enough pull, you're the last one on the list. And when they reach down the money bucket, they said ain't none there, because it's all been given away. But I think with our legislators, Burt, and Burt's on his second term down there, Holloway's on his eighth. And I think Phil's on his fourth or fifth term. and he's a Senator Pro Tem, so I think we certainly got some clout, Dan and Raleigh, and we're certainly going to work towards that, that goal to make sure that everybody in this county got broadband. That'd make everybody happy too, and that's what we need to do, the right thing to do. This time we're 10 minutes ahead because we can't do public hearing until 7 o'clock. So if there's no objection from the commissioners, I'd like to now go down to number 9 and ask Ronnie Tate to present his item. Any discussion, anything?
Well, let me ask you, you think that this issue might take a little longer than 10 minutes? You might want to do a number 11.
You think it's going to take longer? I'm going to let you make that call. If not, I'm going to drop down to another.
I think some of the board members probably got some questions. That's why I'm asking.
Okay, let's wait a second.
Okay.
Or number 10. Or
yeah. Can we?
We can do 10. I think we can do 10 and 11, knock them one out.
Yeah, mine shouldn't take long. And you've got the appointment nomination for the volunteer agriculture advisory board in front of you. And that is David Isley. He's got my understanding he's got experience in that area, and it's up to your consideration.
Mr. Chairman, if you're ready for a motion, I'll make a motion on it.
I'll certainly, if there's any discussion concerning this nomination.
I'd just like to say, and I had the privilege of serving with Mr. Isley here for several years, and he's certainly a fine individual. I think he'd be a good appointee.
And I too will certainly endorse him. So if there's no further comment, I'll entertain a motion for approval.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion to appoint Mr. David Isley to the Voluntary Agricultural Advisory Board.
Okay, have a motion for the approval of the appointment. Do I have a second?
Second.
Have a second by Commissioner Caldwell. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, likewise. Okay. Let's go ahead, County Manager, and the new business item.
Yeah, I can run through it quickly. It's the Association of County Commissioners. Every 2 years, they request that all counties come up with legislative issues, and they do an extensive process to come up with the goals for the upcoming year. The five, just briefly, are opposed shift of state transportation responsibilities to counties, reinstate the ADM and lottery funds for school construction, opposed unfunded mandates for shifts of state responsibilities to counties, ensure adequate mental health funding, and preserve the existing local revenue base. These goals are the top five, but there are, if you look at them, there's several goals within each functionality. They have different committees that are set up. They've got the Agriculture Committee, the Environment Committee, Health and Human Services, Intergovernmental Relations, Justice and Safety, Public Education, and Tax and Finance. And I know how they work because I serve on the Environmental and the Intergovernmental Relations, and they spend the whole day going through a lot of the local legislation that we submit to them. They're asking for all the counties to support their efforts, and they've got many counties so far that have already approved the resolution. They're going to be our advocates at the state level. While we're advocating, there'll be additional advocates for us, and I would request that you all consider approving the resolution which is in your packet.
Okay, to add on, Lance, to what this entails is week before last, I went down to Durham to discuss these legislative goals, and there were 88 counties represented by either a commissioner or a county manager or a or representative of that county, but there were 88 counties represented. There was a lot of debate on all the issues, and then we actually took a vote of how we rank our top five items. They pull those rankings together, and once they pull them together, they take the top five, and they're the ones that they really push hard for to make sure that they do get those five in. They also do not turn their head to the other items. They also attack those as they come up. and push and advocate for those and lobby for those items so they can save us some money. So our lobbyists down there out of the NCACC are very powerful. And once all the counties endorse what we voted on, then that's even a stronger endorsement when they can carry it to their legislators for each different county and say, hey, these people supported it. Every county voted for it. You know, you need to be behind this this item. So that's what it's about. And it's certainly, I think I ended up getting 4 out of 5 of my items that I wrote down in there. But certainly, I encourage the approval of this, but just wanted to give a little clarity of how it come about and how we made this happen. Any questions, Commissioner Carpenter?
No question.
Commissioner Duncan?
Just one quick question on the extra, on the beer and wine sales tax. I believe if I'm reading that right, that is an option to go up 10 cents to 20 cents. Was that right?
Which
I'm on the very last page, TF-17.
Yes.
I mean, is that something? If the state approved that, is that be would that be for all 100 counties, or is that something they're leaving each county the option to do, or do you is it got that far along?
Well, from what the discussion that was had down there, it would give the counties the option. And a lot of these bills that they were looking at trying to push and pass, and if they get them passed, it just gives more flexibility to the counties to do what they need to do.
Yeah, because I noticed that 7 cents of that would be dedicated to law enforcement and 3 cents to rehab purposes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's all.
Okay. Mr. Pat?
I just got one, T16 right above that one. I think that's right in line with Bobby's talking about broadband, and I guess give me some clarification on that.
That was a hot topic as well.
T16.
We called TF16. It's on that same page, just fourth one up from the bottom. Now, they had a lot of discussion about that, of course, looking at revenues of how to do that.
To me, that's about the same, Mr. Chairman, as creating E North Carolina again.
Well, that didn't, it got some discussion, but it didn't get a lot of pull with all the other items that we had to get in, you know, trying to get the ADM money in, trying to keep the state from dumping the road system and so forth on us and all like that. It got some discussion, but got very little action.
With these, when we look at the, this is, you said it was 16, they rank them one through it. So if it's past 10, I mean, the odds of it getting anywhere are well, slim.
Is that something that we can strike out, saying we don't just support that part, but we support everything else? Or do we have to take the whole package as is?
That's up to the commissioner.
I would recommend taking it as is. County manager said that some of these items will never hit the floor because they're so far down the list.
We'll just give Berta and Brian and Berta a call.
Yeah, you're exactly right. So if there's no further discussion, I'll entertain a motion for approval of the resolution. So we have a motion for approval by Commissioner Richardson. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a second by Commissioner Cardwell. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise. So carry. It is promptly 7 o'clock.
Good call.
I won't do that again in the court order.
Mm-hmm. Lucas time. Luke. Luke's time.
And this time we'll call on Mr. Lucas Carter to come up for the public hearing. And we do have one person has signed up for the public hearing comment, so don't make sure I don't forget that.
Good
We're talking amongst ourselves. Okay. Go ahead. All
right. We're still trying to work out this high tech stuff we got there.
Yeah, me too.
Go ahead.
All right. Miss Kathy Roudabush for Triad Road Maintenance Company Incorporated is requesting rezoning case number 2013-002. This request is a rezoning request from residential agricultural to highway commercial. Please note that on your request for board action, it states that this request is to the neighborhood commercial zoning district. It's actually, that was a typo, it's actually the highway commercial zoning district. And in your packet, you received a list of permitted uses. That is for the highway commercial zoning district. That's the correct list of permitted uses for this request. The property itself is located at 2688 Gibbs Road. You can see the map for orientation.
It's this property here.
A little piece of property right beside the red one. And this is a straight rezoning request. And you'll notice that in previous zoning requests, you might have been able to add conditions to that. In this case, you would not be able to add conditions. You're provided the list of uses, and the applicant would have the right to choose any one of those list of uses that are allowed by right. So please consider each use when you are considering this rezoning request. The Planning Board voted unanimously 11-0 to recommend approval of this request at its January 17th, 2013 meeting. And planning staff also recommends approval of this request. And I can entertain any questions that you have at this time.
Okay, let me see if there are any Lucas. Commissioner Travis has got a few questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Lucas, I've always been curious. I get these all the time, but it never tells me what the purpose of the rezoning request is for.
For this one, because it's a straight rezoning, they have the right, or would have the right, if you approve the rezoning request, to choose any one of the uses that are allowed in the highway commercial zoning district. So in this case, they can't tell you exactly which use they're requesting. They're actually requesting to be able to use it, or to choose from the uses that they would be able to have. If it were a conditional district request, then it would be for a specific use. In this case, it's not.
So they don't have to do. They don't have to tell me by law what they're wanting to do.
That's correct.
Okay.
By law, you can't consider any specific use. You have to take into consideration each use that's allowed in that zoning district.
When you change a zoning request like that, does the property value go up?
I'm not a real estate appraiser. I can't answer that.
Well, that's not known. In a straight rezone, you're looking at the land where it's situated, the parcels around it, and your land use plan to see if it's compatible to be zoned the district that's proposed. And you know, in this one, as you see the map, it's adjacent to a heavy industrial on one side, adjacent to a highway commercial on the other, and there are other highway commercial parcels nearby.
Okay. I mean, I'm fine with it.
Okay. Commissioner Duncan?
No.
Mr. Corker?
I don't have any questions.
No questions, Commissioner. The only question I have for you, was there anybody that called in opposition?
My records here show that there was no one that called in opposition. Also, no one signed up to speak against this request at the planning board hearing.
Okay. All right. If you just stand by right there, Lucas. Kathy
Roudabush,
hope I got close.
That was close.
Yeah. Okay, I'm sorry if I messed it up. Would you like to come up to the podium and speak for it?
Sure.
And there may be some questions that the commissioners may have for you as well. But gives you the opportunity to speak.
All right. Good evening, my name is Kathy Roudabush. I live on Sims Road in Reedsville, and we're asking for this property to be rezoned to highway commercial. We also own, I don't know how to work this high tech stuff.
But if you look to the west, the property that's directly adjacent to this lot, we also own that, and it's also already zoned highway commercial.
Okay. The question I have, I recall we did some rezoning a year ago for a guy who was going to put a garage or something back on a property right before you get to the Vance Street cutoff.
I think it was across the street.
Yes, across the street.
Was that across the other side of Ruby?
Okay. All right. I got you now. Okay. I just wanted to see in proximity. I knew where that was, and I just wanted to see in proximity of that. Okay. Commissioner Caldwell, have you got any questions for Kathy?
I think it's pretty clear.
Okay. Commissioner Richardson?
Did you have a specific purpose in mind, or is this just to generally improve its flexibility of the entire piece of property?
Exactly.
You kind of tricked me.
Exactly.
Exactly what?
No, we, like I said, we own the property that's adjacent to it, and we'd like to have this zone the same so that we can use it for our business that we're moving there.
That's just a confirmation. Makes total sense to me. Thank you.
Okay. Commissioner Duncan?
Yes.
Commissioner Travis?
I have no problem with this, Kathy. I think it's great. I'm hoping that you'll expand. I hope you start hiring. And if I can do anything to help you, just let us know.
Absolutely. Thank you. We hope so, too.
Okay. Now, I want to thank you for looking at future investments. So, thank you a whole lot.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, if you're ready for a motion, I'll make a motion.
Sure, and we will have to. How is that phrase? I can't, counselor. The phrasing on the.
You need to adopt the analysis, consistency analysis statement as part of your recommendation.
Chairman, I'll make a motion for case number 2013-002, rezoning request and approval of the. What's it called again? Analysis? How about that?
Analysis and statement.
Okay. What do you say?
Okay, analysis and statements. Commissioner Travis has made the motion. Do I have a second for approval?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Duncan. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, likewise? So carried. Thank you all a whole lot.
Thank you very much.
All right. At this time, Mr. Ron the tape.
Try it again.
You're on.
Okay. I wanted to give the board an update tonight of where we stand with the Western EMS base. On January 8th, we received 13 bids for the EMS base project. The low bidder was S&S Building and Development LLC from Greensboro. Their bid for the project was $1,039,538. Once we received the bids, staff and design team met to try to look at ways to value engineer the project and see if we could lower some costs or come up with some cost savings. After these meetings and much discussion, we presented the list to the emergency managers, Johnny Bowles and Rodney Stewart, for their approval to lower the cost that we came up with. Staff, these emergency managers, and county manager were able to find approximately cost savings of slightly above $99,000. These reductions save money but do not affect the functionality or the use of the EMS base. And if you'd like, I'll be glad to go over these individual items with you and on these cost savings. That's okay. All right. If you look at your sheet in your packet, we have the construction low bid of $1,039,538. In preparing a budget for this project and looking at it, we have design fees of $70,000, testing fees of $4,000, contingency fund that was in the original budget of $60,000 when this was, I think, funded back in 2008. And we had a recommended fee for furnishings, fixtures, and equipment of $50,000. And this came from the architect. They recommended a 5% fee for this. That gives us a total cost for the EMS base of $1,223,000. Our original budget for it was $912,000, so that put us roughly $311,000 over budget. So once we found out that, we started working on the cost savings and or the value engineering. The first one on the list is to reduce the fees and the bonding from lowering cost. If you'll see the asterisk next to that, that number will vary slightly because they presented more items for us to lower cost. We didn't accept those. So that number is going to be slightly less than that. I'm not sure exactly what it is or will be until we get back to the contractor and they look at this and they'll come back with a solid number for that. The next item is a job site sign, a reduction of $1,000. We asked the architect if we could minimize submittal requirements and requests for this project to help the contractor with some of the paperwork and assistant time involved in this and submitting the paperwork for this project. They worked with the contractor on this item and came up with a number of reduction of $1,570. We looked at changing the regular wall panels from what was specified of the insulated wall panels. The insulated wall panels were part of the package to the architect had for the North Carolina Energy Code. What we're going back to is a standard metal building wall panel with vinyl faced insulation in it, and on the inside of that we'll have metal studs with drywall over them with regular bad insulation in there. That's a savings of $14,700. We asked to change the brick or the concrete cap over the brick veneer to a brick roll lock. That's a savings of $3,315. We moved the kitchen appliances, the window blinds, and the metal shelving that's in the project to the furnishings, fixture, and equipment budget item. This will take this out of the contractor's hands. We will be getting that and installing these items through maintenance. And that'll save us the cost of installation and profit and overhead. We asked to reduce the thickness of the concrete slab in the truck bay from 8 inches to 6 inches. And that's a savings of $1,570. The note with that is this will be approved by the structural engineer before we will okay this. We asked to get to have a redesign of the driveway to bring the driveway closer to the building. It was moved out from the building at one time to in the plans that Mayadan might want to put a fire truck and add a bay to that building at some point in time. That has changed, so we've asked them to redesign that and move that driveway closer to the building, saving $8,000 in driveway costs. We've gone to using high density asphalt and low density asphalt in areas for the driveway and the parking instead of concrete. That lowered the cost by $8,666. There is a water header going into the building for the sprinkler system. It had a chrome finish on it. We changed it to bronze finish, saving $700. The PVC piping that was above the slab floor was originally called for cast iron. We asked them to change it. I'm sorry, the piping was cast iron. We asked them to change it to PVC, savings of $1,000. They had specified in the electrical package of furnishing site lighting for the site the DMS base is on. We're asking to lease that from Duke Power. If we do that, it's a savings of $15,750. While it is a savings, we will still have a lease payment to Duke Power for the term of the lease. So it's not a complete elimination of the lighting. It's just changing it from buying it to leasing it. We asked to change the EMT tubing for the wiring to metallic clad wiring. The EMT tubing was commonly known as conduit. It's a savings of $1,500 to do that. The contractor came back and asked for to use a generic light package. It's a savings of $4,700. This would have to be approved by the architect and the electrical engineer. They also asked for a change in manufacturer of the plumbing fixtures, a savings of $3,460. This also will need to be approved by architect and mechanical engineer. We've removed the two-year warranty on the hot water heater, a savings of $1,866. The water heater will have a one-year warranty on it. And we asked to change the trench drain manufacturer, saving $1,434. This will also need to be approved by the architect and the structural engineer. The trench drains are in the, there's two lines of them in the truck base. Total cost savings with these were $82,348. If we go back to looking at the budget again, the construction cost savings lowered the construction cost down to $957,910. We have the engineer and designing fees that are already in the project of $7,000. The construction testing fees are $6,412. On the previous page, the $4,000 number was a misprint on my part. The actual cost from ECS for testing is $6,412. The contract from S&S included a contingency fund of $23,920. So we reduced the contingency fund down to $40,000. The contingency from the contractors for problems with soil, problems with rock, those type of things encountered on the site. We left the furnishings, fixture, and equipment cost in there of $50,000. This gives us a revised budget of $1,123,602. Budget savings of $99,938. If you take the original budget from that number, we're requesting additional funds of $211,602 for the project. I'll be glad to answer. That's a lot of numbers. I'll be glad to answer any questions I can.
All right, well, they're going to be coming.
Okay.
We're going to start with Commissioner Travis. He wants to go first.
Okay.
I'm going to go first on you, Ronnie. First of all, let me say, I appreciate you and the staff, working with the engineer, and I'm sure y'all made some phone contacts with other contractors and architects to come up with ideas on how to cost save. But I want to say I really appreciate you going an extra mile to find them little cost savings, because you know, even $700 is a cost savings to me. I mean, I know it's a big project, but with that said, I've got some concerns. Well, one of my concerns is the thickness of the concrete.
Okay.
Now, you go around to the fire departments, they've got 8 inches on there. I know they use bigger equipment than EMS, but some of them been sitting there for 25 years. I ain't never had to replace no concrete.
Right. And as I said, it'd be one of those things that it, the structural engineer would evaluate, and if they felt like the vehicles that EMS would have in there would be better suited or support wise with 8 inches, they would recommend that we would leave it in as 8 inches.
Right.
So there are some items that will need further review from different parts of the design or engineering team for approval.
Right. I mean, I understand that, and you definitely want to hear from your engineers to make sure that we're within, I guess, PSI with the concrete and everything. So, with that said, I know Lance and others have talked to your personal friends and that you know in the business, Ronnie. And
we have, and
my understanding, now you correct me if I'm wrong, that most of their bids are way higher than this.
We some of these we've gotten back are higher, and I think it goes back to the type of building that you're bidding. This is a 24-hour facility. We have people sleeping there. We have to protect them appropriately. We want a building this is me speaking personally from the maintenance department, that we don't have a lot of maintenance on, that we have a building that lasts for years and years to come, and we don't have to spend a lot of time fixing things or repairing things.
Right.
And I think that's what the design team and engineering team tried to provide to the county, was that type of building.
Right, and you know, Lance, you correct me if I'm wrong. This was part of the CIP that's on your taxes, that 5 cents. So, you know, I think they budgeted what, about $850,000 for that project, but this was back in 2008. So, you know, of course, everybody knows 5-6 years from then, prices of materials gone up. So, we would love to have it at $850,000. I think everybody on this board understands the price of things going up. So, you know, with you and Lance and others looking at this so closely, I just want to make sure this is what you want, because we don't want to be back there 10 years from now saying, hey, we got problems, because I think, what is Rodney, that Reasonable EMS base, that we're having problems left and right with that, right? We definitely don't want to go back and having problems.
We, everything we looked at, because there were several other items that we left out, because we just felt like for whatever reason they would present a maintenance issue down the road or affect the functionality of the base, and those were the things we were trying most to maintain. And we had the meetings with Rodney and Johnny and covered all of these, and I think they're comfortable with them, right, in the changes we're making. But that was the main thing. We want a long-lasting base with as little maintenance as possible.
Right. Well, Pat, I want to make sure I got it on record. Now, we've had a certain amount of money in our CIP account to fund this, and this was approved back in 2008 to do this. So we're obligated to get this done based on the whole process of the COP, right?
That's right.
So we're really just looking at increasing the funds that was allocated. What was it, $800,000? We're increasing it $211,000, right? And it could have been, before Ronnie and him got on it, it could have been $300,000 or $400,000, right, extra. What's you're good with this? You know, we're not taking any new funds away from the taxpayers. This money's not coming out of our general fund. This is coming straight out of the CIP account. Am I right?
Right. We had in our 2008 COP bond issuance, we still have some funds left over in the courthouse judicial building project that we're going to tap into to do. So it's no new monies are being.
No new money.
Just moving.
I just wanted that on the record so everybody knows. No new money, no new taxes, no new nothing. No new money. Thanks, Pat. Thank you. Lance, you are in agreement with this, right? Okay.
Commissioner Duncan?
Oh, you said ECS. Is the GC responsible for that, or are we?
The testing, we do that as a county, because the results are, we don't want the contractor picking the testing agency. All of our projects, we do, the county pays for the testing. The contractor just schedules it for it as needed.
And in his base bid, the site prep, he had, I guess, underneath the foundations, he got his stone built into that cost, I'm sure.
Yes, sir.
So I can see, you know, if you go down and look at this, and I'm real familiar with this kind of stuff, is what I do, but, you know, if you look at these potential add-ons, additional costs, I can't imagine us getting into any type of rock situation. I'm real familiar with that area. And I helped build McMichael School years ago. And the only problem you got out there is shale. And, you know, it's on down in the ground. So, you know, that should be a cost savings. And the soil is pretty good out there.
Yes, it should
be. You had some bores done, didn't you?
Yes.
On the site. So, yeah. I think it's very possible you would come in under budget on this thing. That would be my hopes. And, I think you couldn't have picked a better location, so I'm ready to go forward with it. And quicker the better, because the last thing we want to do is extend it over 60 days, because according to law, he's obligated under 60 days to hold his bid, and we're already, what, at 30,000?
Just about at 30 days.
And if I put myself in the GC shoes, he's ready to move.
Right.
To get his bond and get on with it, so I think we need to move.
Okay, thank you, Commissioner Duncan. Commissioner Cartwell?
Ronnie?
Yes, sir.
I don't want to do anything that's going to hurt the integrity of the entire project.
Mm-hmm.
Because I want this thing to be there. I want it to be first class for the next 30 years. I don't want to have to touch it. I don't want to have the taxpayers to have to spend any money on it. So I don't want to shortcut things to the point that it puts us right on the edge.
Okay.
I like the 8-inch concrete in the base.
Okay.
Because I know what 8 inches of concrete will do. It's rated at 3,000 pounds per square inch. If you go to a 6-inch concrete, you're going to have to go to a 4,000 PSI to get the same thing. I would just assume to stay with the 8-inch. I've had good experience with 8-inch concrete and fire trucks sitting on it for 40 years and not a crack one.
Okay.
And the only other thing, asphalt. I like concrete better than asphalt because of the extreme heat that we have here and the extreme cold. And it changes a lot day to day. One day it's hot, next day it's cold, so it's doing a lot of expansion and contracting. And if you get a heavy truck on asphalt and a hot day, 95 and 100 degrees, guess what? That asphalt's going to come up and you're going to have to redo it. We have repaved asphalt 3 times in the last 25 years,
mm-hmm.
and that's a significant cost that you have to go back and do from time to time. And I look at this and just keeping the concrete in and keeping it 8-inch concrete, you're only talking about 10 grand.
That's right.
You know,
10,000.
And if you had to go back and repave that asphalt 2-3 times, you're going to spend a lot more than 10 grand, I can tell you that. So,
I'm certainly open to any suggestions from the board if that's y'all's pleasure.
Thank you, Commissioner Caldwell. Commissioner Richardson?
Yeah, you know, nobody ever answered what was the footprint weight of the vehicles that are going to be on there, which is a determining factor about concrete and several other things. I'd be interested in knowing that at your leisure. I know you don't have that in your pocket. I got a couple things that kind of...
Commissioner Richardson, Rodney, do you know the weight of those vehicles by any chance?
I don't. I want the footprint weight.
I'd have to get back.
Okay. All right.
We had weighed them before.
And that's what your engineer should have asked for before they gave you recommendation on PSI. I personally have had plenty of good results with 6-inch concrete, but... we want the right stuff for the right job. Just out of curiosity, how much does the job sign cost? It says you reduced the price of it $1,000.
We eliminated it.
Yeah, we eliminated the sign.
Oh, good answer.
Yeah,
good answer.
Yeah. and one of the things we proposed too, we have a sign making machine in maintenance now, and we can even make the sign for
sure.
That ourselves.
Sure, I'll get a Crayola or something. I think taxpayers would be upset if we were spending $1,000 on a temporary sign. And I was also curious about removing a 2-year warranty on a hot water heater. How much does a hot water heater cost if an additional year's warranty is $1,800?
And I don't have the specific number for the heater itself. It is a commercial grade hot water heater though.
Okay. There are a couple things, and I promise you not to give you a hard time here, but you know I've been looking at a lot of these
right.
details. I do think that we have excess expenditures, and I frankly believe that the responsibility for that lies primarily with the architect. I'm not at all sure that we're getting value for money. I totally agree with my other commissioner friends and people in the public. We don't want a facility that shortchanges the EMS fee. We want it to do the job. But when I look at the cost for high back and several other things in here, it seems extremely high. Now I realize it's a commercial building to some degree, even though it's public purposes. You need to look at it that way. You've got sprinkler systems in it that most of us don't have in our homes. But most of us have pretty good homes to stay in 24 hours a day,
right?
Without paying over $200 a square foot. And as a matter of principle, I would like to see anytime we contract with an architect, that we include in these specifications comparison points on cost. It's like this particular architect, and I haven't looked through all the specs and details, and it's unfair to him, but as a matter of principle, we should expect our architects to have the best interest of the taxpayer as one of their criteria when they come up with a design. I'm going to let it go with that.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Commissioner Richardson. When you get into a commercial water heater, which when I was with Morgan Mechanical and started up both Mr. Reuter and Mr. Electric, we installed some commercial water heaters for Applebee's and those folks like that. And depending on what size you're talking about, if you're talking about a 80-gallon gas quick recovery, then you're looking at anywhere between $6,000 and $8,000. You know, I mean, that's what they'll run. And they're very efficient, and they're should last you 20 years. Most of the ones that we replaced were because they wouldn't drained out and sediment rusted the bottom shield out of it.
Right.
But they are expensive, but I see no need in having an additional warranty on it, because these things are commercial water heaters. 1 year warranty is fine. If anything's gonna happen to any of the unit or the electronics of the unit, it's gonna happen in 60 to 90 days. After that, hey, you're good to go for several years. I did, when we sat down and with the architect, several of us, I sat down and we kicked around some of the items that to eliminate, and some of the ones that didn't make sense, like doing away with the downspouts and saving $350, the rain downspouts, saving $600 to go from a two-by-two tile ceiling, the drop-in tile, go from a two-by-two to a two-by-four. And over some years, the two-by-four ceiling tiles will collect moisture. Then that's when, if you've been in some buildings that had two-by-four ceiling tiles on them for quite some time, you'll see them start sagging and drooping, some of them falling out. That's because these things absorb moisture. A two-by-two is structured enough to where it won't give you the droop and stuff like that. So some of the small savings, we just didn't see the need to cut those out, because it just didn't make good business sense to do that. Now, I'm pleased that they found $89,000-$90,000 worth of savings. And I also got with two commercial contractors, that did not have a dog in the fight. They didn't put an offer in. And out of the 13 bids, I believe it was 13 that was submitted.
Correct.
I had these two separate people, separate contractors, commercial contractors, to look at the bids, just look at the bids, and tell me how tight they were, or were we getting, where was everybody being very competitive? And as tight as these bids were, and several of them, you know, was in the 1039, 1079, range and so forth. There was some that was in the 11, 1.1 mil range, this, that, and the other. But if you take the totality of the 13, those bids were extremely tight. And the words that came out of the two contractors I talked with is that they're bidding them as close as they can to keep their people working and to make margins amount of money. So I feel confident based on the 2008 bid, or the 2008 quote, I guess you'd call it, or estimate that they had in 2008. And both of these contractors were telling me that material costs have went up anywhere from 5% to 8% in the last, each year, over the last 4, 5, 6 years. Then, the additional money is probably probably justify. But I'm tickled to death you saved this much out of it, and all we have to kick in is a couple $100,000. As far as the asphalt goes, I certainly agree with Commissioner Cardwell. You know, we need to make sure we don't blow that. As far as shooting ourselves in the foot.
Right.
But it's something I think we need to get confirmation from the structural engineers and those guys before we make a decision. Because last I checked, I mean, I got some licenses, one on real estate. It ain't going to give me the thought process of asphalt. That's my comments on it. I'm tickled to death that we have an opportunity to do it, and I wished it was done in 08 when the material costs were a lot lower. But can't do anything about that now. We've got to finish the job.
I just have one quickie on redirect. Did they consider tankless water heater?
Honestly, I don't know if they did or not. I think this one's an 8 gallon gas, if I'm correct. I think that's what they are using. I don't know if the architect looked at a tankless or not.
To give you some insight on a tankless for commercials, and we did put in some of those. One of the ones we put in is a Renai, but that's just a name brand. If you're going to put in a Renai tankless, it's only going to give you around 12 gallons a minute hot water. Of course, they save you on gas because you're not burning gas. Only time you burn it's when it's activated and the demand's there. But you'd probably have to have a cascade system, have two or three lined up, so it'll give you enough gallon per minute that you need. That's only a huge difference between going with one commercial tank, gas commercial tall boy is what I would call it, rather than a cascade system. But it still would be a great question to ask, because 3 years ago, the RI-90, which is the Renai-90 unit, was running about $1,500. They're probably a lot less now.
Quickly, Ronnie, is it the warranty, would it start for the GC, would it start at substantial completion of when we receive the CO?
When we receive the CO.
Okay. Thank
you. Mr. Chairman, if there's no more of the discussion, I'd like to make a motion.
If there's no further discussion, I'll entertain a motion for approval.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion for approval with the premise of the structural engineer recommendation, and if taken more, then we will need to come back to S&S and sign a contract.
Okay. Yeah, you have to sign the account.
All right. As I understand it, there are two things you're actually looking for tonight. One is adjustment of the budget upwards.
Right.
And the other is award of the contract to the low bidder, which would be subject to final successful negotiation of contract terms with the county.
That's correct.
And I'm not quite sure of the phrasing of your motion. I don't know if you had both of those things in there.
Well, you know, I make a motion for approval of the lowest bidder with the budget revisions that's been requested. Is that correct, Bob? And based on my figures, I want to increase the budget provision to 230, because I like the 8-inch concrete, and I like the asphalt recommendation concrete for that. So how you want us to do it, Bob?
I mean, I think that's sufficient. You've increased the budget $230,000, and awarding the contract to...
Is it S&S?
S&S Builder and Development.
S&S Builder and Development.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Which would receive the contract subject to final negotiation, successful negotiation of the terms with the county.
Okay, so.
There you go, I'll make that motion, Bob. You said it right there, brother.
So, as I hear it, Commissioner Travis, you are making a motion for the approval of the awarding of the contract to S&S.
Yes.
And to.
Additional budget.
Increase the budget to do not exceed.
$230,000 additional.
$230,000 additional.
And whatever Bob said.
Yeah, I got that in on the front side. Okay, I have a motion made to award the contract to S&S and the additional funds to be added as a do not exceed $238,000.
Hey.
Go ahead. Okay.
I just want to stress that we can't force them. Can we strongly encourage this contractor to buy local if it's at all possible? I know you can't force them to.
We do it every, okay. Everyone we try, we pass out the local vendor list and try to encourage it at every opportunity, every all meet. Right. That's what we've been doing at the library at all the meetings.
Okay. And that's strong has been suggested in every meeting. Okay, a motion's been made. You got further discussion?
Still need a second.
Need a second.
Second.
Okay, a motion made by Commissioner Travis, second by Commissioner Cogwell. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise. So carried. Thank you. Hold on, Ron. All right. At this time, there's no other items other than closed session, but I would like to let everybody know our next meeting is February the 18th here in the chamber. And is there a reason to go into closed session? My understanding there is the economic development issue.
Yes, the board needs to go into closed session under General Statute 143-318.11A4 to discuss matters relating to the location of expansion of industry.
Okay.
Just a five-minute break with that.
Okay, well, yeah, we can get that in as well. All right, need to go into closed session. I'll entertain a motion to go into closed session for the item that our attorney had suggested to us.
I move for that.
Okay, I have a motion made by Commissioner Travis. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a second by Commissioner Duncan. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise. We're in closed session. Thank y'all a lot.